What do the furthest star in the cosmos, the smallest particle of an atom, and the screen you're watching this video on have in common? The answer is physics. Physics is the science that unearths the fundamental principles of the universe, guiding everything from the tiniest quarks to the largest galaxies. It's the reason the planets orbit the sun, why buildings stand up, why your coffee cools down, and even why your phone works. It's everywhere, and it's a part of everything we do, from the times of Newton and Maxwell, through Einstein's groundbreaking theories, to the quantum world of Planck and Heisenberg. The story of physics is a grand tale of discovery. Today, we're going to embark on an epic journey through the story. In this physics crash course, we'll delve into the key areas of physics and explore the core ideas that make our universe what it is. Whether you're a curious student, a passionate enthusiast, or someone just looking for answers to the universe's big questions, buckle up. This is going to be an exciting one. Bring a pen, a paper, and your favorite snack. And if you are always curious to know everything, make sure to subscribe and hit the bell icon. You won't regret it. Let's start. Physics is mostly split into three big sections: classical physics, quantum physics, and relativity. We'll start with classical physics. The best person to start classical physics is Isaac Newton. His three laws of motion explain how objects move. Imagine it like we're talking about how cars or soccer balls behave. Ever tried to push a heavy box? It's tough, right? This law says that an object at rest stays at rest, and an object in motion stays in motion, unless something causes it to change. So, if you slide a toy car on a smooth table, it will keep sliding until something, like friction, the force that slows things down, stops it. This one's about the connection between an object's mass, how much matter it has, its acceleration, how fast its speed changes, and the force applied to it. Let's say you and your friend, who's twice as heavy as you, are on identical skateboards. If I push both of you with the same force, you'll move or accelerate faster because you're lighter. The more force we use or the less mass an object has, the faster it accelerates. This law says that for every action, there's an equal and opposite reaction. So, if you've ever jumped off a small boat, you've probably noticed that the boat moves backward. That's because the force you applied to jump forward also pushes the boat in the opposite direction. Let's imagine a fun day at the playground. You've probably noticed that when you jump up, you always come back down. This is because of gravity, a force that pulls objects towards each other. Newton's law of universal gravitation tells us that every object in the universe attracts every other object with a force that depends on two things. How much mass do the objects have? Mass is like how much stuff an object has. Think of a basketball and a marble. The basketball has more mass, so it would pull things more strongly. How far apart the objects are? The closer objects are, the stronger the pull. That's why we don't feel the gravity of a basketball, even though it's pulling on us. Because we're so much closer to the Earth, and Earth's mass is a lot more than a basketball. Newton also invented calculus, which is a super powerful mathematical tool. Optics is a branch of physics that deals with the properties and behavior of light, including its interactions with matter and the instruments used to detect it. It covers a range of topics including reflection, refraction, diffraction, dispersion, polarization, and interference. Let's discuss some of the key topics in optics. Historically, light was seen through two main theories: the particle theory, which proposed that light was made up of tiny particles, and the wave theory, which saw light as a wave phenomenon. Modern physics has unified these views under the theory of quantum mechanics, where light is seen as both a particle, photon, and a wave, electromagnetic wave, depending on the context. This is known as wave-particle duality. reflection is the change in direction of a wavefront at an interface between two different media so that the wavefront returns into the medium from which it originated. Refraction is the change in direction of a wave passing from one medium to another caused by its change in speed. An example would be light entering the water from the air. Lenses and mirrors manipulate light by reflection and refraction. A lens refracts light to create a focused, magnified, or reduced image. Lenses are key components of many optical instruments, including glasses, cameras, microscopes, and telescopes. Mirrors reflect light to form an image. Mirrors can be flat, producing a virtual image that is the same size as the object, or curved, either concave or convex, each producing different types of images. These phenomena demonstrate the wave nature of light. Interference is the process where two or more light waves superpose to form a resultant wave of greater, lower, or the same amplitude. Diffraction involves a wave spreading out as it passes through an opening or goes around an object. This is the process where waves of light or other radiation are restricted to certain directions of vibration. Imagine if light waves were like a skipping rope. If you could only move the rope up and down, but not side to side, that's sort of what polarization is. This is the phenomenon in which the phase velocity of a wave depends on its frequency, often observed in light as the separation of white light into its constituent colors when it passes through a prism. This field of study uses quantum mechanics to understand how particles of light, photons, behave. It provides the foundation for technologies such as lasers and quantum computing. There are many instruments based on the principles of optics, including microscopes, telescopes, and cameras. Modern applications of optics include fiber optics and optical storage devices in the field of information technology. This technology uses thin fibers of glass or other transparent materials to transmit data in the form of light signals. It's widely used in telecommunications, providing high-speed data connections for internet and cable television services. These are devices that emit light through a process of optical amplification based on the stimulated emission of electromagnetic radiation. They have many applications in areas such as medicine, commerce, industry, and research. Now let's jump into electromagnetism. Electromagnetism is one of the four fundamental forces of nature, alongside gravity, the strong nuclear force, and the weak nuclear force. It plays a critical role in how particles with charge interact with each other and with electromagnetic fields. It underpins much of our daily life, from the operation of electrical and electronic devices to the behavior of light, and even some of the fundamental biological processes in our bodies. The theory of electromagnetism was developed by James Clerk Maxwell in the 19th century. He consolidated all known observations and experimental results about electricity and magnetism into a set of four differential equations, now known as Maxwell's equations. These equations describe how electric charges and currents produce electric and magnetic fields, and how those fields, in turn, influence the charges and currents. Here are Maxwell's equations in their integral form. One of the most revolutionary insights that came from Maxwell's equations was the prediction of electromagnetic waves, which propagate through space at a speed equal to the speed of light. This suggested that light itself is an electromagnetic wave, a fact that was later confirmed by experiments. The understanding of light as an electromagnetic wave forms the basis of classical electrodynamics and optics. Classical mechanics is the branch of physics that deals with the motion of objects and the forces acting upon them. Let's discuss some of the key concepts: position and displacement. Position refers to the location of an object at a given time. It's like marking a specific spot on a basketball court where you're standing. Displacement, on the other hand, is the change in position from one point to another. Imagine you start at one end of the basketball court and move to the other end. Your displacement is the distance and direction between the two points. Speed and velocity. Speed is the rate at which an object covers a certain distance. It's like measuring how fast you're riding a bicycle without considering the direction. Velocity, on the other hand, is speed with a specific direction. Imagine you're driving a car from your home to a friend's house. Your speed is how quickly you're traveling, while your velocity includes both the speed and the direction toward your friend's house. Acceleration. Acceleration refers to the rate at which an object's velocity changes over time. It's like how quickly a car can change its speed or direction. When you press the gas pedal in a car, it accelerates, increasing its speed. Similarly, when you hit the brakes, the car decelerates, decreasing its speed. Friction. Friction is a force that opposes the motion of objects when they come into contact with each other. It's like the resistance you feel when trying to slide a heavy box across a carpeted floor. The rough surface of the carpet creates friction, making it harder to move the box. Friction can also be observed when you rub your hands together quickly, generating heat due to the resistance between your skin surfaces. So what is a fluid? Imagine you have a glass of water. The water can flow and change its shape to fit the container. Similarly, fluids are substances that can flow and adapt to the shape of their containers. Think of fluids as shapeshifters that can take on different forms. Fluids have a few key properties that affect their behavior. Density. Density refers to how much mass is packed into a given volume of a substance. It is a measure of how tightly packed the molecules are within a fluid. Think of density as how tightly packed the molecules in a fluid are. Imagine a swimming pool filled with syrup compared to one filled with water. The syrup is denser because its molecules are more closely packed together. Viscosity. Viscosity is the property of a fluid that determines its resistance to flow. Viscosity is like a fluid's thickness or resistance to flow. Think of honey and water. Honey is more viscous than water because it flows more slowly due to its thicker consistency. Pressure. Pressure in fluid mechanics is like the force exerted by a fluid on its surroundings. It's similar to the pressure you feel when you dive underwater. The deeper you go, the more pressure you experience because there's more water above you pressing down. Buoyancy. Buoyancy is the upward force exerted on an object submerged in a fluid. It's the reason why objects float or sink in liquids. Think of a boat floating in water. The boat's shape and size displace a certain amount of water, and the upward buoyant force from the displaced water keeps the boat afloat. Bernoulli's principle. Bernoulli's principle relates the speed of fluid flow to its pressure. Imagine you're riding a bicycle and feel a strong breeze hitting your face. When you're moving fast, the air pressure around you decreases, creating a lower pressure area. Similarly, when fluid flows faster, its pressure decreases. This principle helps explain how airplanes fly and how water circulates in a garden hose when you partially cover the nozzle. Fluid dynamics. Fluid dynamics is the study of fluid flow. It's like understanding how traffic moves on a road. You can observe the flow of cars, how they interact, and how traffic jams occur. Similarly, fluid dynamics examines the movement and behavior of fluids, whether it's the flow of water in rivers, the movement of air in weather systems, or the circulation of blood in our bodies. Thermodynamics is a branch of physics that deals with the study of energy and its transformations. It may seem complex at first, but let's break it down. Energy. Imagine energy as a currency that can be exchanged or transformed. Just like money, energy can be stored, transferred, and used to do work. Different forms of energy include heat, light, electrical energy, and mechanical energy. System and surroundings. Think of a system as a specific area or object you want to study, while the surroundings include everything else outside that system. For example, if you're studying a cup of hot coffee, the coffee is the system, and everything else in the room is the surroundings. Temperature. Temperature is a measure of how hot or cold something is. It's like the intensity of heat. When two objects at different temperatures come into contact, heat flows from the hotter object to the colder one until they reach thermal equilibrium. Means similar temperature. Heat. Heat is a form of energy that flows from a higher temperature object to a lower temperature object. It's like pouring hot water into a cold cup. The hot water transfers its heat energy to the cup, making it warmer until both the cup and water reach the same temperature. Work. Work is when energy is transferred to or from a system to cause some kind of change. It's like pushing a heavy box and moving it from one place to another. The force you apply to the box does work by transferring energy and causing the box to move. There are three main laws that govern thermodynamics. First law, the law of energy conservation. It states that energy cannot be created or destroyed. It can only be transferred or transformed. This is similar to your monthly budget. The total money you have remains constant even if you spend it on different things. Second law, the law of entropy. Entropy is a measure of the disorder or randomness in a system. The second law states that the entropy of a closed system tends to increase over time. Picture a messy room. If you don't tidy it up, it will become even more chaotic over time. Third law. This law deals with absolute zero temperature, where a system has no thermal energy left. It states that as a system approaches absolute zero, the entropy approaches a minimum value. Think of it as the point where things become as organized as they can be. Heat engines and efficiency. Heat engines are devices that convert thermal energy into mechanical work. A car engine is a familiar example. It takes the heat generated by burning fuel and transforms it into the mechanical energy needed to make the car move. The efficiency of a heat engine is a measure of how effectively it converts heat into work. It's like the gas mileage of a car. The higher the efficiency, the more work you get out of the same amount of heat energy. Phase transitions. Phase transitions occur when matter changes between solid, liquid, and gas states. Think of melting ice into water or boiling water to form steam. These transitions involve energy exchanges and changes in the arrangement and motion of particles. Chaos theory is a fascinating scientific concept that studies complex systems and how they behave in unpredictable and seemingly random ways. Imagine you have a simple system, like a pendulum. Normally, you would expect the pendulum to swing back and forth in a regular pattern. Chaos theory comes into play when small changes in the starting conditions of the pendulum can lead to vastly different outcomes. Instead of a predictable back and forth motion, the pendulum might start swinging erratically, making it challenging to forecast its behavior precisely. Chaos theory emphasizes that complex systems are highly sensitive to their initial conditions. To illustrate this, imagine a game of pool. When you strike the cue ball with the same force but change the angle ever so slightly, the outcome can be drastically different. A small variation in the initial setup can result in the balls scattering in various directions, making it challenging to predict where they will end up. Chaos theory deals with nonlinear systems, which means that small changes in one part of the system can have disproportionate effects on the whole. This can be compared to a traffic jam. At first, traffic flows smoothly, but as soon as one car slows down slightly, it can create a chain reaction, causing congestion that affects many other vehicles. Even a tiny change in one car's speed can lead to a significant impact on the overall traffic pattern. Fractals are intricate, self-repeating patterns found in nature and are closely related to chaos theory. Consider a cauliflower or a tree. Both have branches that split into smaller branches, which then split into even smaller branches, and so on. Each level of branching follows a similar pattern as the whole, creating a fractal structure. Fractals highlight how complexity can emerge from simple rules and repetition. Chaos theory introduces the concept of strange attractors, which are patterns that complex systems tend to settle into over time. Think of a whirlpool in a river. The water flows and twists, creating a spiraling pattern that seems to be attracted to a central point. This represents a strange attractor. Even though the water's motion appears chaotic, it exhibits a recognizable pattern that remains stable over time. The butterfly effect is perhaps the most famous aspect of chaos theory. It suggests that a small change in one place can have significant consequences in another place. Imagine a butterfly flapping its wings in Brazil. This seemingly insignificant action can set off a chain of events that, through a series of interactions, may eventually lead to a tornado forming in another part of the world. The butterfly effect emphasizes how tiny causes can have enormous effects in complex systems. Chaos theory has practical applications in weather forecasting. Weather is a complex system influenced by numerous variables like temperature, humidity, and wind speed. Even a tiny error or uncertainty in measuring these variables can make long-term predictions challenging. This is due to the sensitive nature of weather systems and their susceptibility to chaos. It's why meteorologists often provide forecasts with a range of possibilities rather than definitive outcomes. So that's all of classical physics. This is all we have in the year 1900s, but there are still some unexplained phenomena that Newton's laws couldn't account for, such as the behavior of light and the motion of Mercury. Then Einstein's theory of special relativity and later his theory of general relativity revolutionized our understanding of space, time, and gravity, and had a profound impact on various scientific disciplines and our overall worldview. Let's dive deeper into it. First, let's talk about classical, or Newtonian, physics. According to Newton, space and time were absolute and independent of each other. He believed that objects moved through space in a predictable manner, and time flowed at a constant rate for everyone, regardless of their speed or location. But along came Einstein and turned this classical view of the universe upside down. He proposed two fundamental theories of relativity, the special theory of relativity and the general theory of relativity. Let's focus on the special theory of relativity for now, which deals with objects moving at constant speeds. Special theory of relativity has two postulates. This principle states that the laws of physics are the same in all inertial frames of reference. This means that if you're inside a smoothly moving train with no windows, there's no experiment you can do to tell whether the train is moving or stationary. Think about being on an airplane. When the airplane is moving at a constant speed and altitude, you can walk up and down the aisle, pour a drink, or even toss a ball in the air, just as you would do on the ground. The laws of physics work the same whether you're on the ground or in a moving plane, as long as the plane's movement is steady and smooth. This states that everyone, no matter how fast they're moving or in what direction, we'll always measure the speed of light in a vacuum to be the same, roughly 299,792 kilometers per second. Imagine a highway on which all cars, no matter their starting point or direction, always travel at exactly the same speed, say 60 miles per hour. Even if you try to race next to them, no matter how fast or slow you go, from your perspective, they're still moving at 60 miles per hour. This is very counterintuitive, unlike anything we experience in our day-to-day life. But that's the nature of light. These two postulates lead to some amazing and non-intuitive consequences. Time dilation. When a clock is moving relative to an observer, the observer will see the clock running slower. This is known as time dilation. Imagine you're watching your friend fly by in a spaceship. If your friend had a clock that ticked every second, you'd see it ticking more slowly than your own clock. The closer to the speed of light the spaceship travels, the slower the clock seems to tick. This isn't an optical illusion. Time itself is perceived to slow down. This has been confirmed by experiments with atomic clocks on fast-moving airplanes. Length contraction. The length of an object is perceived to shorten when it is moving relative to an observer. This is known as length contraction. Consider a spacecraft flying past you at near the speed of light. If you could somehow take a measurement, you would find that the spacecraft is shorter in the direction of motion. Again, this isn't an illusion but a real physical effect, albeit one we don't experience in everyday life because it only becomes significant at speeds close to the speed of light. Mass-energy equivalence, E equals mc squared. This famous equation tells us that mass and energy are interchangeable. A small amount of mass can be converted into a large amount of energy, and vice versa. This principle is what powers the Sun and other stars. They convert mass into energy through nuclear fusion, releasing vast amounts of energy from a relatively small amount of mass. Similarly, nuclear power plants and atomic bombs work on the principle of converting a small amount of mass into energy. After the special theory of relativity, in 1907, Einstein started exploring the equivalence principle, which states that gravitational acceleration is indistinguishable from acceleration due to other forces. This principle suggested that gravity could be viewed not as a force but as the curvature of space and time. General relativity is a fascinating theory that explains how gravity works and how objects move in the presence of massive bodies. Gravity is a fabric. Imagine that the fabric of space and time is like a trampoline. When you place a heavy object, like a bowling ball, on the trampoline, it creates a dent or curve in the fabric. The heavier the object, the deeper the dent. Similarly, massive objects like stars and planets create curves in space and time. Curvature of space-time. Curvature of space-time. This curvature affects how other objects move around the massive object, just as a marble placed on the trampoline would roll towards the bowling ball due to the curvature of the fabric. In the same way, objects with mass move along curved paths in space and time due to the curvature caused by other massive objects. Time dilation. According to general relativity, time is affected by gravity. Think of time as a river flowing at a constant speed. When you're near a massive object, like a black hole, the river gets stronger and faster. As a result, time flows slower in strong gravitational fields. This effect is known as time dilation. It's similar to how a clock on a spaceship orbiting close to a massive object would tick slower compared to a clock on Earth. Bending of light. Another fascinating aspect of general relativity is how gravity can bend light. Imagine you're playing a game of pool on a curved surface, like a billiard table with a dip in the middle. When you shoot a ball towards the center, it follows the curve and deviates from a straight path. Similarly, when light passes through a region with a strong gravitational field, it bends or gets deflected. This effect was famously observed during a solar eclipse when starlight was observed to bend as it passed near the sun. Black holes. Black holes are objects with extremely strong gravitational fields. Picture a drain in a bathtub. When you remove the plug, water starts swirling around the drain and eventually disappears. In a similar way, when a massive star collapses under its own gravity, it forms a black hole. The gravitational pull of a black hole is so intense that nothing, not even light, can escape its grasp. It's like a bottomless pit in space from which nothing can emerge. Gravitational waves. General relativity predicts the existence of gravitational waves, which are ripples in the fabric of space-time caused by accelerating massive objects. Imagine shaking a rug vigorously, and you see ripples propagating across the surface. Similarly, when massive objects, such as two merging black holes or neutron stars, accelerate or collide, they create gravitational waves that spread outwards through space. These waves carry energy and can be detected by specialized detectors on Earth. Expansion of the universe. General relativity also provides insights into the overall structure of the universe. Imagine inflating a balloon with dots on its surface representing galaxies. As you inflate the balloon, the dots move apart from each other, indicating the expansion of the universe. The space between galaxy groups is expanding, causing them to move away from each other. This expansion of the universe is a key concept explained by general relativity. Atomic theory, specifically in the context of quantum physics, is a scientific framework that describes the behavior and properties of atoms, which are the smallest units of matter. It focuses on understanding the behavior of particles at the atomic and subatomic levels. Imagine atoms as the fundamental building blocks of matter, similar to Lego bricks. Just like you can combine Lego bricks to create different structures, atoms can combine to form different substances. Particle nature of atoms. Atoms are made up of even smaller particles called protons, neutrons, and electrons. Protons have a positive charge, neutrons have no charge, and electrons have a negative charge. Energy levels and electrons. Electrons exist in specific energy levels around the nucleus of an atom, much like planets orbiting around the sun. These energy levels are like different floors in a building, and each floor can hold a specific number of electrons. Quantum jump. When an electron absorbs energy, it can jump from one energy level to a higher one. Think of this like an elevator moving up from one floor to another. When an electron releases energy, it jumps back down to a lower energy level, just like an elevator descending to a lower floor. Wave-particle duality. Electrons, and other particles at the atomic level, can behave as both particles and waves. It's similar to how light can act as both a particle, photon, and a wave. This is a fundamental concept in quantum physics. Uncertainty principle. The uncertainty principle states that we can't simultaneously know both the exact position and momentum of a particle. It's like trying to determine the precise location and speed of a fast-moving object at the same time. The more we know about one aspect, the less we know about the other. Superposition. Quantum particles, such as electrons, can exist in multiple states simultaneously. This is called superposition. Think of it as a coin being in both heads and tails positions until you observe it. Only when you measure or observe the particle does it collapse into a specific state. Entanglement. Entanglement is a phenomenon where two or more particles become connected in such a way that the state of one particle directly affects the state of the other, regardless of the distance between them. It's like having two entangled coins, where flipping one coin instantly determines the outcome of the other coin. Quantum tunneling. Quantum tunneling is the ability of particles to pass through barriers that would normally be impossible to overcome. It's like magically teleporting through a solid wall without breaking it. This phenomenon allows particles to tunnel through energy barriers. Applications of quantum physics. Quantum physics has many practical applications. For example, quantum computers use the principles of superposition and entanglement to perform complex computations. Quantum cryptography uses the principles of quantum mechanics to secure communication and prevent eavesdropping. The double slit experiment is a fundamental concept in quantum mechanics, illustrating the duality of matter, the idea that all particles exhibit both particle and wave properties. Imagine a wall with two thin slits in it. Behind this wall is another wall where we can mark where anything passing through the slits hits. Now, you're standing on the other side of the wall with a paintball gun, shooting paintballs one by one. If you shoot paintballs at the wall, sometimes the paintballs hit the first wall, and sometimes they go through the slits. Whenever a paintball passes through a slit, it ends up leaving a mark on the second wall directly behind that slit. If you keep doing this, over time, you'll end up with two bands of color on the second wall directly in line with the two slits, just like you would expect. Now, instead of paintballs, imagine you're at a water's edge, and the slits are in a seawall with a calm pool behind it. If you create a single wave in the water, like dropping a pebble, it moves towards the seawall. When it hits the seawall, the wave splits into two smaller waves at the slits. These waves then interfere with each other in the calm pool. In some places, they add up, constructive interference, like two waves combining into a bigger one, and in other places, they cancel out, destructive interference, like the peak of one wave filling in the trough of another. The end result is a complex pattern of waves in the pool, with areas of calm water and areas of big waves. Now, let's talk about the weird stuff, how particles like electrons or photons behave. Let's go back to your paintball gun, but now it's a special gun that can shoot electrons or photons. You fire them one at a time, and they either go through one slit or the other. But something strange happens. Instead of just two bands on the wall behind the slits, like the paintballs, you get an interference pattern, with multiple alternating bands of high and low intensity. It's as if each electron or photon is interfering with itself as the water wave did. But how can one particle go through both slits at the same time? That's the first strange thing. But it gets weirder. Say you want to catch the particle in the act of going through both slits. You set up a detector that can tell you which slit the particle goes through. When you turn on the detector, the interference pattern vanishes. Instead, you get the two-band pattern like you shot paintballs, as if the particle knows it's being watched and decides to behave like a normal particle instead of a weird quantum particle. This is known as wave function collapse. So, the double slit experiment reveals the strange quantum reality. Particles behave like waves when they are not observed, but like particles when they are observed. This is a fundamental mystery of quantum mechanics, and the best we can do is to describe what happens, not why it happens. Heisenberg's uncertainty principle is a fundamental concept in quantum physics. It states that we cannot know both the exact position and the exact momentum of a particle at the same time. The more accurately we know one of these values, the less accurately we know the other. To fully appreciate this, let's first explore the terms. Position. It means where something is. Think about the GPS coordinates of your home, your position on a football field, or where your favorite book is on your bookshelf. Momentum. It's the product of an object's mass and its velocity, speed in a given direction. Consider a rolling bowling ball. It has more momentum than a marble moving at the same speed because it has more mass. Imagine you're at a party and you're playing a game of blindfolded tag in a large room. You can think of the people running around as particles. When you hear someone running by, you can guess their position. But, by the time you reach there, they may have moved. They are not locked into a position. The best you can do is to guess a range where they might be. On the other hand, if you catch someone, you can tell their position. They're right in your hands. But you have no idea about their momentum anymore. You don't know which way they were heading or how fast they were going. This is the essence of Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. The more precisely you try to measure one aspect, either position or momentum, the less precisely you can know about the other. A key thing to remember is that this isn't about our measuring tools being imperfect. It's an intrinsic part of nature at the quantum level. Even if we had perfect measuring tools, we would still encounter this uncertainty. Energy quantization is a fundamental concept in quantum mechanics which states that the energy of certain systems, such as electrons and atoms, can only take on certain discrete values, as opposed to any value within a certain range. This is unlike classical physics, where energy can usually vary continuously. Let's begin with the word quantization. The word quantized means to restrict something to a set of discrete values, rather than allowing it to take on any value. Think about digital music. The sound is broken up into little bits called samples, and each bit is a small chunk of the whole sound. Analogous to this, in the world of quantum physics, energy is also quantized. It can only exist in certain, discrete levels. Energy levels and quantum leaps. Imagine you're at a staircase where each step is a different energy level. Now, unlike our usual experience of climbing a staircase, where you can stop at any height you wish, like half or a third of a staircase, in the quantum world, you can only exist on the steps themselves. There's no in-between. A system, an electron and an atom, for example, can only exist in these specific energy states, and when it changes from one state to another, it has to jump or leap from one step to the next without being in-between. That's often called a quantum leap. Energy packets, quanta. The term quantum itself comes from the Latin quantus, for how much. It refers to these discrete packets of energy, with the smallest possible packet being one quantum. This concept of energy packets is a bit like a bag of candies. You can have one candy, two candies, three candies, and so on, but you can't have 2.5 candies. Just like you can't have half a candy, unless you break it. But let's suppose our candies are unbreakable. Energy comes in these indivisible packets called quanta. Photon, a real-life example. A real-life example of energy quantization is seen in light, which is composed of particles called photons. Each photon is a packet, or quantum, of energy. The energy E of each photon is proportional to its frequency F, which can be calculated using the equation E equals HF, where H is Planck's constant. In essence, this equation says that the energy of a photon can only be a certain value if its frequency is a certain value. We can't get a photon of just any arbitrary energy, just like how we can't have just any arbitrary fraction of a candy in our previous analogy. Alright, let's break down Schrödinger's equation, which is one of the fundamental equations in quantum mechanics. It's quite abstract and can be complex, but I'll do my best to use simple analogies to explain its concepts. The time-dependent Schrödinger equation looks like this. Imagine you're at a lake and you drop a pebble into the water. Ripples spread out from where the pebble entered the water. The pattern of ripples could be thought of as similar to the wave function of a quantum particle. The wave function tells us about the waves associated with a quantum particle. But instead of ripples on a lake, the waves are probability waves. They tell us the likelihood of finding a particle in a particular place at a particular time. This is like watching how the ripples in the lake change over time after you drop the pebble. As time passes, the ripples spread out, change shape, and eventually disappear. The time dependence in Schrödinger's equation similarly shows how the wave function, and thus the probabilities of finding a particle somewhere, changes with time. The Hamiltonian operator is the total energy of the quantum system. It's like knowing the total energy you have for a road trip, including both your kinetic energy, the energy you have from moving, analogous to your car's speed, and potential energy, energy you could potentially have, analogous to the amount of fuel in your tank. Planck's constant is a fundamental constant of nature that sets the scale for quantum effects. Its smallness is why quantum effects aren't typically observed in everyday life. In our analogy, it's like the scale of your map during your road trip. A small-scale map, like Planck's constant, might make small side roads, quantum effects, seem insignificant, but they're crucial when you zoom in, or when you study the very small, like atoms. This is more abstract. The imaginary unit is used in mathematics to handle quantities that can't be expressed as real numbers. In quantum mechanics, it's crucial because it allows the wave function to oscillate, which in turn allows particles to behave as waves. Imagine you're walking a dog and sometimes you go into an open field. In the field, the dog can roam around you in circles. The path of the dog isn't a straight line, a real direction, but it's an important part of the dog's overall trajectory. Think of the Schrödinger equation as a kind of quantum rulebook that the universe follows. Given a quantum system and how it changes over time, the equation allows you to calculate the system's future behavior. Just like knowing the speed and fuel level of your car, the Hamiltonian lets you plan your road trip. Physics is an ever-evolving field, and there is always more to learn and discover. By unraveling the mysteries of the universe, from the smallest particles to the vastness of the cosmos, physics helps us comprehend our place in the universe and how everything is interconnected. Thank you for joining us on this journey through the wonderful world of physics. Make sure to subscribe and press the bell icon for exciting courses and videos. Keep exploring, stay curious, and never stop asking questions.